Okay, so I will give a talk on high adelic theory, and there will be many sections, parts in this talk, and it will last for 75 minutes. I will start with going to the roots, which are in this case class field theory. So in order to understand various developments in modern number theory, it's better to go to the roots and to look at at the history. Do you see my slides?
Yes.
Why are you laughing?
No, I did mistake on the jump, sorry.
Okay. So so here is a diagram of class field theory and three of its main generalizations. Class field theory is abbreviated as CFT. And then we have like three branches. One is Langlands program, Langlands correspondences. I have some very strange things. And then maybe higher Langlands correspondences. Then there is another branch which includes higher class field theory and higher adelic theory. And finally, there is yet another branch which goes to an abelian geometry already mentioned earlier today in Laurent's talk, and then to inter-universal Tuck-Muller theory. So some of these directions use geometry, and in particular, an abelian geometry, inter-universal Tuck-Muller geometry, high adelic theory, which includes high adelic geometry. And of course, as it's well known, some Langlands correspondences also use geometrical arguments. And in particular, there is geometrical Langlands program, which is quite geometrical. So in very down to earth form to talk about why geometries can be useful for number theory from a slightly different perspective than how it was presented in the previous talk. One can say that when we use geometries, we use the right hemisphere of the brain and to do various activities and investigations to study structures which are typically normally studied by the left hemisphere. And so in some sense, using geometries for number theory allows us to use more power of our brains. And the number of different geometries which already had various applications in number theory is really huge. And so some of them are listed on this slide. So now I'll just briefly discuss some aspects of class field theory, because understanding them clearer helps to appreciate the relations between different generalizations of class field theory and is of direct relevance for this talk. So the first thing to understand that class field theory has two substantially different parts. One is special class field theory, and it uses torsion division points or values of functions at torsion points to generate finite extensions of the base field, which is a number field or a local field, and to describe the Galois action on them. So here, historically, everything started with cyclotomic theory, and then there was complex multiplication theory using elliptic curves. And then the strongest version of such theories was given by Shimura using abelian varieties with complex multiplication. So these theories provide a lot of information, but they are not extendable to arbitrary number fields. They work only over very specific number fields. And in particular, none of the theories are functorial. So Hilbert, a long time ago, 121 years ago, asked in his problem number 12 about extensions of special class field theory to other number fields. But so far, the best was achieved by Shimura. As far as his local special class field theory is concerned, Then there is a very well-known Lubin-Tate formal groups, local class field theory, which works over any local field with finite residue field. And it's a local analog of complex multiplication theory, so to say. Now there is a general class field theory, which is very, very different, which follows very different conceptual patterns than special class field theory. So the list of general class field theories for arithmetic fields includes the work of Takagi in 1920, almost 100 years ago. And this work, he was the first to derive so-called general existence theorem and produce its applications. That was without the reciprocity map. The reciprocity map was constructed by Artin later, some eight years later. And then the Haas started to use H2, Galois homology H2 in modern notations. At that time, it was called the Brouwer group. And he was the first to develop local class field theory, which did not exist before Hasse. And then he studied local to global aspects. And then an important role played the invention of Idels by Chevalier, which simplified the expositions of general class field theory and allowed to construct the global reciprocity map as the product of local reciprocity maps. So all these classical approaches to general class field theory presented in various texts, and in particular, finding explicit formulas for the Hilbert pairing and its generalizations. It's another Hilbert problem, number 9. Played an important role in order to get more explicit information about the reciprocity map. So the disadvantage of cohomological methods, which were of course induced by developments in algebraic topology, was that the key role there is played by a cup product of H1 with H1 to H2. And this cup product is very inexplicit. Therefore, even though cohomological approaches establish the reciprocity map, it's very hard to compute which elements go to which Galois automorphisms. And this is unfortunate non-explicit nature of the cohomological approach to class field theory. So then there was another development about general class field theory. It's called explicit general class field theory. And it was produced already later in the 1970s. It started with a so-called Dvorak lemma with states proof in Dvorak's paper. And then it was a contribution of Hasewinkel and Neukirch. So this theory is explicit general class field theory. This approach clarified and made explicit some of the key structures of class field theory. And these theories are much less dependent on torsion, and they do not use H2 at all. They do not use the Brouwer group in particular. And also these theories are explicit and algorithmic. There is a concrete algorithm given how to compute the image of Galois of an element and to produce a Galois automorphism. Also, the theories in some sense are much easier than special class field theories, even though they work over arbitrary number fields and functorial. And finally, they really explain what class field theory is about. So this explicit class field theory, general class field theory, was described in two Springer books by Neukirch. So in particular, this class field theory, explicit class field theory, includes so-called class field theory mechanism. That was a very important discovery by Neukirch. This mechanism is of general nature. So you don't need to know over which field you want your class field theory to be produced. You just make a small number of assumptions, and then you get the reciprocity map. So I'll just briefly sketch this class field theory mechanism, which will be essentially the only more precise mathematical part of this talk. Everything else will be rather general. So I consider this class field theory mechanism very important, and then I dedicate maybe 5 minutes to discussing it. So what happens in this class field theory mechanism? We can start with arbitrary abelian topological group A, endowed with continuous action by profinite group. Say, let's denote the profinite group G. And we can think, suppose that this is the absolute Galois group of some field. It's then, we have labeling by the field K and its extensions. It's separable extensions. And so now let's make two assumptions. The first assumption is assumption A, that there is a surjective homomorphism, let's call it degree, from this group G to the procyclic profinite completion of integers that had. So it's a surjective homomorphism. So in other words, we assume that K has a z-hat extension. So let's denote its kernel by G K tilde. So then K tilde over K will be exactly that z-hat extension. And then this degree map at the level of the full group G automatically induces degree maps, which are surjective homomorphisms onto z-hat for finite extensions K capital of K small. So you just use this degree map and divide by appropriate number. And so we can now talk about the degree map for any finite extension, separable extension K capital of K. And let's call any element of the absolute Galois group G K capital, which is sent to one by the degree homomorphism, let's call it a Frobenius element. So a little later for local fields, this will be a typical usual Frobenius automorphism, but in general, it does not need to have any relation to Frobenius automorphisms. So we have just special elements which called Frobenius elements. They are not uniquely determined. So now assume, let's make a second assumption, assumption B, that there is a homomorphism from the group A, which we can also denote as AK, such that the image is either integers or z-hat. So the image is either cyclic or procyclic. And such that for every open subgroup, we have a certain relation between the values of V on the norm group associated to that subgroup and the value of V on the original group. So this relation is given by this formula. So then if we denote by A subindex K capital, the JK capital fixed elements of A, then we have similarly to the previous activity, how we produced the degree subindex K, we can produce a version of this homomorphism V for the field K capital, V sub index K capital, which will be now acting from AK capital to Z hat. So for local fields, V can be viewed as a discrete, as the discrete valuation, as a surjective discrete valuation onto integers. But in general, for other fields, its image will be not necessarily integers. It can be the procyclic profinite completion of integers. And extensions of the field K capital inside this composite can be viewed as unramified extensions with respect to the pair of the degree and V. And so now, similarly to the definition of a Frobenius element, let's defined what a prime element of A K capital is. It's just any element which goes to one with respect to V K capital. So we have Frobenius elements, we have prime elements. For local fields, they will correspond to the usual notions, otherwise they will be some new objects. And so now finally, in order to define a reciprocity map, Suppose we have a finite extension, separable extension K capital of the original ground field K small. And suppose we have a finite Galois extension L capital over K capital. And let's take any element Galois automorphism sigma in the Galois group of L capital over K capital. So then it's very easy to see that there is a lift of sigma to an element, to sigma tilde in the Galois group of this field extension. It's an infinite field extension, such that its degree is a natural number greater or equal than one, and such that its restriction on the field L coincides with sigma. So in fact, there are infinitely many such lifts, but at least there is at least one lift. So we'll use this lift very soon to describe the reciprocity map on the next slide. So the original pair, the degree and V, defines now an explicit reciprocity map. So the finite Galois extension L over K corresponds to the normal subgroup GL, which is open subgroup of G capital K capital, which itself is a subgroup, a closed subgroup of finite index in G capital K. And the reciprocity map acts from the Galois group of L capital over K capital to this quotient group, to the kernel of the norm map. And so the definition is strikingly simple. Galois automorphism sigma goes to the image with respect to the relevant norm map of a prime element pi of some new field sigma modulo this norm subgroup. And sigma capital is the fixed field of that lift, sigma tilde. So this is the definition. With this definition, in general, this map is not even well-defined. So one needs to do something about, one needs to impose additional restrictions in order that this map is well-defined. And then typically we introduce axioms of class field theory, which are properties with respect to, say, H0 and H1, the index of the norm group for abelian extensions and Hilbert theorem 90. And so if these axioms are satisfied, then one proves, it's not difficult, that this map is, first of all, well-defined. And then it's a homomorphism and it induces an isomorphism from the maximal abelian quotient of the Galois group of L capital over K capital to the kernel of the norm map. And moreover, this homomorphism satisfies all standard properties of class field theory. So this is a very, very simple and very clear construction, in fact. But it's interesting that this construction involves various indeterminacies. The non-uniqueness of the choice of the lift of sigma and the non-uniqueness of the choice of a prime element. And still the answer does not depend on these indeterminacies. Also, this class field theory mechanism is purely group theoretical. And it does not use anywhere the ring structures. For example, it does not use the ring structure. Oh, something happened. It does not use the ring structures of the ground field K. However, to verify axioms of class field theory, one needs to use the ring structure for concrete fields. And this is exactly when the ring structures of fields come into play. So for local fields, it's just the usual class field theory. And for global fields, one uses as a z-hat sub-extension, the maximal abelian extension of rational numbers inside its maximal abelian extension. And of course, there are analogies of this in positive characteristic. So this approach works simultaneously for local fields and for global fields, which is very interesting. Typically, you really have to do things differently in the when you pass from local to global fields. But here we have a universal class field theory mechanism, which works simultaneously over local and global fields. And I would like just to recall that there was a very long classical study of class formations in class field theory, which aimed at stating as few as possible class field theory axioms from which then class field theory can be deduced. And from the point of view of this Neukirch mechanism, we can say that this long-term search for class formations can be interpreted as distinguishing purely monoid theoretical aspects of class field theory, namely class field theory mechanism, from ring theoretical aspects, which in this case are exactly proving axioms of class field theory. So I finally make two remarks here. So the first remark is that in his explicit general class field theory, Neukirch was partially motivated by his previous work in Abelian geometry of number fields. It's so-called one-dimensional Abelian geometry, which was not mentioned in the previous talk. So the main result there is the Neukirch-Uchida theorem. And the second remark is that, I already mentioned it, explicit general class field theory does not involve H2 or the Brouwer group. So this information related to the second remark still seems to be relatively poorly known among number theorists. And in fact, class field theory seems to be relatively poorly known among modern number theorists. So now I will just tell a little bit about the left branch and the right branch, the two generalizations of class field theory. So the first is Abelian geometry and also its further development, which is IUT. As I already mentioned, the early work in Abelian geometry is due to Neukirch and then Iwasawa, Ikeda, and Uchida. So this can be viewed as one-dimensional Abelian geometry. It basically says that ring homomorphisms between number fields correspond to outer homomorphisms between the absolute Galois groups. So this early work used class field theory to establish such results. And then two-dimensional Abelian geometry, in other words, for hyperbolic curves over number fields, was anticipated by Grothendieck and pioneered by three Japanese researchers, Nakamura, Tamagawa, and Mochizuki. And the main theorems were, complete theorems were proved by Mochizuki. Now, Abelian geometry includes several types of theories, one of which is so-called bi-Abelian geometry, which is restoring isomorphism classes of scheme theoretical objects from the fundamental groups and morphisms between those fundamental groups, and mono-Abelian geometry, which is restoring the scheme theoretical object from, for example, its fundamental group or a map from its fundamental group to the absolute Galois group of the ground field. So all these theories are group theoretical, topological group theoretical, algorithmic, especially mono-Abelian geometry, and explicit. And these three features are very, very similar to explicit general class field theory. So there are various powerful restoration results in mono-Abelian geometry, which were more recently established by Mochizuki and applied in his IUT theory. And so more of some aspects of Abelian geometry and mono-Abelian geometry will be mentioned in the next talk by Wojtek Parovsky. I would like to emphasize that this year, summer and September, we had four RIMS workshops on Abelian geometry and IUT. And their materials include wonderfully given and prepared talks on various issues in an abelian geometry and IoT. And if anyone is interested, they can contact the organizers for links to the talks and to video records. So this is very briefly about one branch. And now very briefly about another branch, which is the left branch, which is another generalization of classical theory, namely the arithmetic Langlands program and Langlands correspondences. So I call it pre-Takagiya Langlands correspondence. And the reason why I call it, because all the main arithmetical achievements in arithmetic Langlands correspondence so far are of special type only. So they are kind of, in some sense, analogous to special class field theory. We still do not have any single achievement in arithmetic Langlands correspondences which are analogous to general class field theory. And so 100 years after Takagi's pioneering work, which started general class field theory, and 50 years after the beginning of Langlands correspondences, we are still awaiting for results of general type in arithmetic Langlands correspondence. Obviously, this is difficult. This is difficult, and this is one of the reasons why we still do not have any single result in this direction. So, as it is well known, most fundamental problems in arithmetic Langlands correspondences still remain open. And in particular, the functoriality conjecture, functoriality issues are open. So one can, of course, ask why. And so maybe one reason for that is that maybe the knowledge, or good knowledge of general class field theory maybe is sometimes missing as a useful theory to use, to apply in the Langlands correspondences. And so I would like to mention a very recent important work of the previous speaker, who proved the equivalence between functoriality in the Langlands correspondences and the existence of certain non-additive Fourier transform satisfying a Poisson formula. And there is some group theoretical aspect of this reformulation, which actually reminds some aspects of an abelian geometry, amazingly. Even though an abelian geometry and the Langlands correspondence go in very different directions with respect to each other. So this is a very interesting aspect. Any possible use or applications of some ideas of an abelian geometry in Langlands correspondences would be very interesting. It may bring better understanding of the issues in Langlands correspondences. So what is one of the reasons distinctive features of Langlands correspondences that they can be viewed as a linear theory of class field theory? Class field theory itself is not linear, even though it's abelian theory, but it's not linear. At the same time, Langlands correspondences are non-abelian, but they essentially linear over the one-dimensional theory. And because Langlands correspondences use representation theory, inevitably working with representations misses various important features of the absolute Galois group that are not of linear nature. And so, for example, an abelian geometry uses the following two group theoretical properties of the absolute Galois group of a number field or local fields. And these two properties is that, first of all, the center of every open subgroup is trivial. And the second, that every non-trivial normal closed subgroup of any open subgroup, which is topologically finitely generated as a group, is actually of finite index in the group. So these properties are not used at all in Langlands correspondences, but they play a central role in an abelian geometry. So I ask this question, whether we can need or whether we can use nonlinear series, and in particular from higher class field theory and Abelian geometry, to help with better understanding of Langlands correspondence, and also maybe develop some Langlands correspondences of general type. This is just one question, but here there is a link to a recently published paper which actually asks many other questions related to the unification of the generalizations of class field theory. So this unification may be related to the unification between different geometries, which is the central subject and motif of the current comma school. So now I go to the central part of, to the central branch of generalizations of class field theory, and stay discussing that central branch of generalizations of class field theory. So this is higher class field theory and higher adelic theory. So it's higher, so it means it deals with objects which are not in dimension one, like the spectrum of the ring of integers, but rather two-dimensional objects. And in fact, I will discuss two-dimensional theories only. And the first is that in dimension two, say, X is a surface, we have already a flex of sub-varieties or sub-schemes. And typically, we have a point on a closed point on a reducible curve, and curve is on the surface. So it's already the inclusion between three types of the data, X in Y in X. This leads to various newer objects which never show up in dimension one. So I will now describe two-dimensional objects of higher adelic theory. So we say we have a scheme S, which is integral normal two-dimensional scheme flat over the ring of over integers or a finite field. And so the first is its function field. It's a global field, but two-dimensional global field. Now, as an analog of local fields, we have two-dimensional local fields, and now they correspond to the data of X, point X on a curve Y on the surface S. So I won't give the definition of such two-dimensional local fields, but I give examples. So these are finite separable extensions of various kinds of fields. For example, formal power series over QP, formal power series over R, formal power series over C, complex numbers, and then mixed characteristic two-dimensional local fields, very interesting objects, denoted like this, and then also formal power series in two variables over finite fields. So these are examples of two-dimensional local fields which show up in the two-dimensional theory. But the distance between these two-dimensional local fields and global fields is very large. And we have two types of intermediate objects between purely local objects and purely global objects. So they are semi-local global fields or rings of two types. And one type is the function fields of associated to curves. More precisely, we take the local ring of a curve on the surface, take its completion, and then takes a function field. So such fields are complete discrete relation fields with global residue field, which is the function field of the curve Y, and with the local parameter, say the local parameter associated to the curve Y. This is one type of intermediate semi-local global objects. Another type of intermediate semi-local global objects, which are not fields but rings, is the tensor product of the function field with the completion of the local ring of a point. So these two types of semi-local global objects correspond either to curves or to points. And from these objects, one can form so-called two-dimensional adels or so-called two-dimensional geometric adels, which will be a certain double restricted product inside the product of all two-dimensional local fields. And then one can also form two sub-adelic objects, two-dimensional sub-adelic objects, corresponding to all curves, so it's denoted B, and corresponding to all closed points, it's denoted C. So overall, we have A, B, C, and K. So they show up on this next diagram. And in fact, we have two more objects. So in addition to A, B, C, and K, we also have some additional two objects, which actually are not geometric adels, but so-called analytic adels. So adels in dimension two is some tool to connect geometry with analysis. And so the second adelic structure, analytic structure, is quite different from geometric adelic structure. And I will say something about this. And there will be more talks on two-dimensional adelic objects at this school. So geometric adelic structure is related to rank one local integral structure. And actually, the additive group of two-dimensional geometric adels is self-dual. And this duality, in fact, is stronger than third duality. And it implies the Riemann-Roch theorem for surfaces. So this will be discussed in the following talks. Now, analytic adelic structure is related to rank two local integral structure. So in fact, in dimension two, there are two different local integral structures, one which is of rank one and another which is of rank two. And so this second analytic adelic structure is not really self-dual, but it's reflexive. The dual of the dual is isomorphic to the original. So there will be some discussions of this later in this talk. Now, I will just briefly mention higher class field theory. So higher class field theory works with higher Kummer theory for Milner K groups. And all existing higher class field theories are general type, of general type. So we do not really have yet any higher class field theory of special type. So it's totally opposite to the situation with Langlands correspondences, where we do not have developments of general type. In higher class field theory, all the developments are of general type. So in particular, one of the approaches to higher class field theory uses a generalization of the Neukirch's class field theory mechanism. All higher class field theories work with Milner K groups in dimension two K2 groups. And one of the main difficulties is then that there is no Galois descent. So the Galois invariant elements of the K group associated to a larger field in a Galois finite Galois extension of fields is not isomorphic to the K group of the smaller ground field in general. So this means that you cannot work with Galois modules and Galois fixed invariant elements of Galois modules. You need to modify the language, but it's known how to do that. And then we have reciprocity maps. We have local reciprocity map. F is two-dimensional local field. So it's Milner K2, or it's quotient by such subgroup. And then we have global two-dimensional reciprocity map, which is the quotient of K2 at geometric adels modulo the sum of the images of K2 of the subadelic subobjects corresponding to B and C. So there is a very substantial problem with higher class field theory. In dimension one, essentially geometry and arithmetic are the same. But in dimension two, higher class field theory, arithmetic, is kind of separated from various geometrical issues. So this causes various difficulties. In particular, higher class field theory has not found as many applications as one-dimensional class field theory. So now I go to the remaining part of my talk, which will be the discussion of analytic aspects in dimension two and how we can relate analysis with geometry and arithmetic. So in the terminology of the previous talk, how can we relate La Grandeur with La Forme and Le Nombre? So we'll see that actually adelic objects and various related structures help to build such bridges. And so this is now the time to introduce the most important analytic object, which is in number theory, which is the zeta function of scheme of finite type over integers. So this is the formal definition of this zeta function. It's the product of Euler factors. These Euler factors correspond to all closed points of the scheme. Kx is the finite residue field of closed point, and this vertical bars denote the cardinality of this finite field. So this is a universal general definition for the zeta function. And so this is the definition of the zeta function as the product of the Euler factors, but of course, one can also write it down as a certain Dirichlet series. This zeta function factorizes into the product of some auxiliary factors and then several L factors of the scheme X, or more precisely of if it's a regular model, then of its generic fiber. So this is how L functions show up. Roughly speaking, zeta functions are products and quotients of various L functions up to certain auxiliary factors. So very little is known about this zeta function in characteristic zero for two and higher dimensional schemes. But as the following theory will show, in fact, the zeta function can be compared to a macro commutative object, whereas its L factors can be compared to micro non-commutative objects studied by using non-commutative methods, for example, in the Langlands program. So the study of the zeta function, the whole macro object, can actually be conducted using commutative methods, as will be described in the rest of this talk. And then higher adelic theory studies such zeta functions by using higher zeta integrals. And this is very different from the use of L functions via non-commutative zeta integrals in Langlands correspondences. So now I will even specialize more to specific type of two-dimensional objects, which are elliptic surfaces. So let's assume we have an elliptic curve over global field, K. And let's take its regular model of the spectrum of the ring of integers of this global field if it's a number field. So we assume that the morphism from this model to the base is proper and flat. Then, as I mentioned, the zeta function factorizes into the product of some auxiliary factor, n, and products and quotients of L functions. In this case, the second factor is factorizes like this. It's the product of the Dedekind zeta functions at S and S minus 1 divided by the Hassevel L function of E. And there is, of course, a precise formula for the auxiliary factor, but so it's included on this slide, but it's not so important what it is. It's just the product of finitely many Euler factors. So what is important, that zeta function essentially corresponds to the product of two one-dimensional zeta functions divided by the L function of the generic fiber. So that zeta function, which appeared as the second factor on the previous slide, it's called Hasse-Weil zeta function. It doesn't depend on the choice of a model. High adelic series studies the zeta function of a regular model of elliptic curve over number field directly using commutative two-dimensional methods. And the Gallo group at the background is the maximal abelian, the Gallo group of the maximal abelian extension of two-dimensional global field. So now, in order to explain what is going later in this talk, I just very briefly review the classical and really very well-known one-dimensional theory about zeta functions. So this is, say, one-dimensional zeta function of one-dimensional global field. And then typically in for number fields, one passes to completed zeta function by multiplying this zeta function by appropriate gamma factor, product of the product of certain gamma functions and the modifications. And then the key point is that this completed zeta function has an integral representation, which is in its adelic form can be written as this famous zeta integral, which showed up in the work of Iwasawa and later in the work of Tate. So it's a very, very important object. Not only in the usual one-dimensional theory for zeta functions, but also an object of great importance for the Langlands correspondence. So let's have a look at the structure of this object. First of all, it's a certain integral. It's a certain integral over the group of invertible elements of one-dimensional adelics with respect to certain measure. This measure is just some appropriately normalized Haar measure on this locally compact group of invertible elements of one-dimensional adelics. So it's already, because of Haar measure on locally compact abelian group, one can use Fourier transform, duality and other things. And then which function do we integrate here? So it's the product of two functions. One function takes into account the integral structure. So it's called Brillouin-Schwarz function, and it's the product of characteristic functions of rings of local rings of integers or the fractional ideals. And at Archimedean places, one gets the Gaussian function or some modification of the Gaussian function. So this is the function f. And finally, this is just the module function associated to the Haar measure of the locally compact abelian group and raised to the complex power s. So this is the module function raised to the complex power s. So we mix in one integral two factors. One kind of corresponds to the integral structure, and the second corresponds to the analytical structure, if you wish, to the translation invariant measure on this locally compact abelian group. So this zeta integral mixes in arithmetic with analysis. So it's a classical theory. I go through it very fast. So it's just the classical work of Iwasawa and Tate, which is like 70 years old, approximately, or 75 years old. So using harmonic analysis and summation formula, one proves that the completed zeta function or the zeta integral is actually the sum of three terms, one of which, the first and the second, is the same entire function, but just corresponding to the original function f or to its Fourier transform f. And here s and there one minus s. And the most interesting is the third term, which is the boundary term, which can be explicitly given in this form. And After some simple computation, it is shown that this boundary term has the factor which is the Haar measure of the quotient of Fidel's modulo non-zero global elements, and then some integral which can be easily computed to be a rational function of X, symmetric with respect to these two operations. So this is a classical computation. So this one computation, essentially in the famous Iwasawa's letter to Giordanone, it fits on two pages. This classical computation proves several central results of algebraic number theory. It proves the finiteness of class number. It proves meromorphic continuation and functional equation of the zeta function. And also it easily implies Dirichlet's unit theory. So this is a very classical theory. And then you can try to extend it, for example, replacing the additive group by reductive algebraic group, adelic reductive algebraic group. And this has links via Goodman-Jacquet theory to L functions and plays a certain role in the Langlands correspondences. But in this talk, we'll actually look rather at its two-dimensional generalization. So the aims of high adelic theory in the case of arithmetic surfaces is to really understand the zeta function working with higher zeta integral, which similarly to dimension one can serve as a bridge to connect arithmetic with analysis and in fact also with geometry. And there are immediately several difficulties. For example, two-dimensional local fields are not locally compact spaces, and there are no usual, in the usual sense, non-trivial translation invariant measures on them. The structure of K2 groups of such fields is not known in general. And arithmetic and geometry are really separated from each other, like in dimension one. So the ways to address these issues is to understand that actually compactness and local compactness is not really important, unlike how it looks in dimension one. And then also understand that actually one can deal with translation invariant measures which take values in two-dimensional Archimedean local fields, like formal power series over reals. And then also understand how to get some information about K2 groups by using the product of two multiplicative groups of two-dimensional objects. So realization of this work leads to various developments in high adelic theory. And so first of all, let me explain briefly how much different is two-dimensional, how much different is rank one integral structure from rank two integral structure. So for example, if we look at this two-dimensional local field, formal power series in one variable over periodic numbers, its rank one integral structure is just integral formal power series. Whereas its integral structure of rank two will be something different from that. And the difference is that the free coefficient, unlike in the previous case, the free coefficient should be a periodic integer, not a periodic number. Instead of QP, here we have the restriction that it's a periodic integer. So in fact, these two integral structures are as different from each other as QP is different from ZP. And it is actually this integral structure of rank two, which is crucial for analytical applications and developments and for the study of the zeta integral in dimension two. Whereas the geometrical integral structure of rank one is hopeless for developing some kind of analysis on it, even though you will see some kind of analysis on such rank one structures in dimension two in one of the later talks at this workshop. So there is a diagram, two-dimensional picture of fractional all submodules of two-dimensional local field. But I don't want to spend time on this. I just emphasize that it's two-dimensional picture, not one-dimensional as in dimension one. And then we have translation invariant measure and integration on two-dimensional local fields. And so this measure takes values not in real numbers, but in formal power series over real numbers. And so this measure integration is translation invariant. And it's almost countably additive with some restrictions which are necessary. And unlike the classical case, this measure integration, they are not compatible with two-dimensional topologies. And in particular, various classical approaches to define and work with measure integration simply do not work, like exterior inner measure and so on. So one needs to do things differently. But this translation invariant higher measure integration compatible with higher measure integration on the residue field, which is one-dimensional field. And already there have been various extensions of this theory to some other cases. So now I'll discuss a little bit two adelic structures in dimension two. Now, the slides contain the definition of the two-dimensional structure and geometrical adels as the restricted product of geometrical adels for all curves with respect to the integral structure of rank one on such adelic structures on curves. So the definition is a little bit technical and also a little bit complicated. So it is included in the slides, and the slides of this talk are available from my web pages. And so I think I'll just skip this definition because it's a little bit complicated. And to explain what's going on, I will have to spend more time. So I'll just say, here is an example in equal characteristic. For each curve on two-dimensional surface, we can associate two-dimensional object AY, which in this case can be informally thought of as formal power series in one variable over the adelic, one-dimensional adelic ring of the function field of the curve. And then we can associate its integral adels, which can be viewed as integral formal power series over the same one-dimensional adelic ring. And then we can associate rank two integral adels, which similarly to the local case replace the free coefficient full adels with integral adels. And we can also define analytic adels, and analytic adels is actually the restricted product of integral adels of rank one with respect to integral adels of rank two. So geometric adels is the restricted product of adels with respect to rank one integral adels, and analytic adels is the restricted product of this rank one integral adels with respect to rank two integral adels. So these two different adelic spaces, objects live in completely different worlds. They are not really much related to each other at the level of their additive structures. So then we have two-dimensional Fourier transform on local fields and eventually on analytic adels. And one interesting thing is that this two-dimensional Fourier transform has various features similar to those of the Feynman path integral, which still is lacking any rigorous justification for when the potential is not of degree two and three and four, but higher degree. So such a higher measure integration and Fourier transform, they extend to analytic adels, but they cannot be extended to geometric adels. However, as I mentioned, there will be some discussions how to do some selective integration on geometric adels in one of the following talks. And now I need to mention that we also have some hints from two-dimensional class field theory. So I just would like to concentrate on the shape. So it's some triangle commutative diagram which allows us to study K2 group of two-dimensional local field, modulo units. And there are two objects on the left side of this diagram. One involves rank one integral structure and the quotient of two-dimensional local field modulo that integral structure at the multiplicative level. And what we have at the bottom, we have the product of two integral structures of rank one, but quotient by integral structure of rank two. So this diagram naturally comes from the, if you want to prove the existence theorem in two-dimensional class field theory. So the formal definitions are given there. And so the meaning of this diagram is that it just helps us to do computations in the object which describes abelian extensions of higher dimensional fields. And they have to use Milne K groups. And what is important here is that in this diagram, the symbol map in K series, the diagonal map, and the other two maps are homomorphisms. So there is also an adelic version of this diagram. Again, I'll just show it without spending time much on its discussion. But what is important here, that now we see at the top the multiplicative group of analytic adels and the multiplicative group of geometric adels, and their tensor product. So this diagram kind of can be interpreted that intertwines the multiplicative groups of these two adelic structures. And this is very important because it potentially gives us a link between the geometrical multiplicative adelic structure and the analytic, the multiplicative analytic structure. And so now we have a two-dimensional zeta integral. So it's just a two-dimensional, an honest two-dimensional generalization of the one-dimensional zeta integral of Iwasawa and Tate. And you see its shape is quite similar to the one-dimensional theory. But now, again, it involves some kind of two-dimensional Brewer-Schwarz function and the module function raised to the complex power S. And the integration is goes over the, not the multiplicative group of analytic adels, but by certain reasons, it has to be over the product of two copies of the multiplicative group of analytic adels. So here is the first theorem, that this zeta integral essentially equals to the square of the zeta function, modulo some other factors which is easy to deal with. So in other words, we have an integral representation of the square of the zeta function of elliptic surface. This is very important because, for example, if only we can get integral representation of L functions, then this would allow to prove very important new results in language correspondences. But we do not have, in general, integral representations of L functions, so Galois representations. Here we have integral representation of the zeta function, more precisely its square. So this is really very important. And also from this, it's easy to see that the zeta integral is holomorphic function on the half plane where the real part of S is greater than two. It's dimension two, so it's greater than two, not greater than one. And now there is also analog of two of one dimensional zeta formula, which reflects certain duality. But now it's two dimensional zeta formula, which is a little more tricky. So it involves the use of properties of two-dimensional Fourier transform. And this two-dimensional zeta formula allows us to replace the integral of the product of two copies of the multiplicative groups of analytic B structure, adelic structure, with the integral over the weak boundary of this space. So it's analogous to one-dimensional zeta formula, but now the right-hand side is much more difficult to deal with than in dimension one. So the next theorem actually, again, is an analog of the one-dimensional theory. It shows that the zeta integral splits into the sum of three terms. The first two are entire functions, and the third term is the boundary term, which has explicit description like this. And so some function h shows up, which has explicit adelic description. And this function h satisfies a certain functional equation. All this comes immediately from this high adelic theory. So this integral, if you make exponential change of variable, it becomes a Laplace transform. And so we can ask the question, what kind of analytic properties the function h, which satisfies this functional equation, should satisfy so that its Hoffmann transform or Laplace transform has meromorphic continuation and functional equation. And then this leads to the notion of so-called mean periodic functions. This is an important notion in modern harmonic analysis, developed after the Second World War mostly, but started earlier by one of the members of the Bourbaki group, Delsat. And so it's the notion of mean periodic function. So it's an element of a functional space such that its translations, the span of its translations is not everywhere dense in this space. Or alternatively, this function satisfies a non-trivial convolution equation like this. So such mean periodic functions typically have a generalized Fourier transform where coefficients are polynomials. Instead of usual coefficients, one gets polynomials. And so here the main theorem is that if this function is mean periodic in certain functional space of smooth functions of exponential growth, then the zeta integral, the zeta function, and hence the L function have meromorphic continuation and functional equation. And in fact, in some joint work with Ricotta and Suzuki, we showed that some opposite property holds. Namely, if the zeta function extends to meromorphic function and has expected analytic shape that satisfies the functional equation, then this function must be mean periodic. So the task is to prove that this function is mean periodic. So books on mean periodic functions sometimes have introductions which discuss the issue that all functions showing up in engineering are mean periodic. And so from the engineering point of view, there is nothing to prove anymore, because in engineering, all functions showing up are actually mean periodic. But of course, well, this is mathematics, and the task to prove that this is a mean periodic function still remains. Now, the second application of this study, I have only two remaining slides, which I cover in the remaining 3 minutes. The second application of this study is applications to generalized Riemann hypothesis. So once again, we have a representation of the boundary term, which knows everything about the poles of the zeta integral. Essentially the Laplace transform of a certain function. If we assume that this Laplace transform is mean periodic, then essentially the poles of the Laplace transform is so-called Carleman spectrum of this mean periodic function. And we are interested in the location of the poles. And we are interested in the location of the poles inside the critical strip. And so one can prove this theorem that if the fourth derivative of this function h capital keeps its sign near infinity, and if the zeta function doesn't have real poles in this open interval, and this is, of course, highly expected, then the zeta function doesn't have complex poles in the same strip. In other words, the generalized Riemann hypothesis holds for this zeta function. And in fact, there is a result of Suzuki which proves the opposite, almost the opposite property. So this is a fundamental difference with one-dimensional case. In the one-dimensional case, the Riemann hypothesis is about the location of the zeros. It's very difficult to study zeros analytically. But in dimension two, the problem becomes about the poles of the zeta function. To study the poles is much easier analytically. And in particular, any kind of analog of the theorem in dimension one, like some sometimes called Polya's approach, cannot work. And in fact, in dimension one, we do not have an integral representation for the inverse of the Riemann zeta function. And finally, I come to the last slide, which is applications of high adelic theory to the Tate-Burchin-Sinnerton-Dyer conjecture. So this is about computations of the local behavior of the zeta function at s equal to 1. So of course we have to assume that the zeta function has meromorphic continuation and functional equation in order to discuss this issue. So now we can use the previous theory, in particular to dimensional theta formula, which reduces the study of the internal integral to the study of the integral over its weak boundary. And we can use this in order to compute the order of the pole of the boundary term at s equal to 1, which will be essentially double the order of the zero of the L function of s at s equal to 1. So this computation requires more information about the boundary of this space. And it's difficult to get this information, of course, because otherwise we would know the location of the poles of the zeta function, which is not what we expected to get anytime soon. But at s equal to 1, the central point, there are additional things which can be used. And in particular, in order to find more required information about this weak boundary, we can use those adelic triangle diagrams at the level of B. And we can use this object at the level of B, which showed up at the top, at the vertex of that diagonal diagram. And this object involves the quotient of geometric adelis, the multiplicative group. The main point is that this quotient of geometric adelis is related to the Picard group of the surface, if you factorize it also by the image of non-zero global elements. So you can use, you can see the geometric rank or the model value rank of the elliptic curve in the structure of this object. And then using the triangle diagram, the structure of this object implies the information about the structure of the boundary of this space, certain partial information. And certain partial information about the integral over that boundary. But still some topological properties are required in order to apply this study. And in particular, such things as the discreteness of global elements in the adelic space is a very important topological property, which is non-trivial in dimension two. And the study of this property is related to the proof of two-dimensional adelic Riemann-Roch theory. So if one combines all this information together, then one can finally relate via this two-dimensional adelic zeta integral the geometric information, the arithmetic geometric information about the most value rank of the elliptic curve over number field or global field with the analytic information, the order of the pole of the zeta function at s equal to 1. And so this opens just a new method to relate these two ranks and to link the analytic invariant, this one, with the geometric invariant, which is the Euler characteristic with respect to the risky topology of the sheaf associated to the invertible elements of the structure sheaf. So this is an example when two-dimensional adelic methods in high adelic theory can provide new links between various fundamental parts of mathematics, in this context, analytic rank and geometric rank. So it's very interesting to compare it with Grothendieck hopes and expectations, what can connect geometry with arithmetic and analysis, and how to connect discrete structures with continuous structures. So in this instance, in my talk, I tried to show that actually there are some other structures like high adelic structures, which can help us to connect all those aspects. All right, so now at this point, I'll stop my talk.